Welcome back to another session, the last one for this week. Today we will discuss about communication, and it's a pleasure for us to welcome all the Indian coaches and of course our friends from the neighboring countries as well. We have coaches online I've seen from Maldives, from Sri Lanka, from Pakistan, and the coaches from Bangladesh are frequently joining as well. Thanks a lot to the General Secretary of the Bangladesh Athletics Federation, Mr. Abdul Rukib. Yeah, today's topic is about communication, which we feel is of utmost importance, because as we've underlined in several occasions during the last days, it's not only the way you apply your training, it's also the way you're explaining exercises. And we mentioned at several occasions that coaches are always relying on the athlete's feedback to make the training more specific, to customize it. And of course, proper feedback requires a very decent communication between you and your athletes. And I'm glad that our deputy chief coach, Mr. Radhakrishnan, today is covering this session about communication with the athletes and also in between the coaches, I feel. Yeah, so we don't waste any time. Mr. Adidas Umaravala, you want to mention something before we start?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Volker. I'm glad to be here. I can't understand in which language I need to speak, because I've spoken in Hindi, I've spoken in English, but people continue to write their names on the chat. I've been saying, please don't write your names. You write your names at the end, because if people write their 800 people write their names, we will lose on all questions that people want to ask. But I can see so many names. I can see Ramachandran. I can see Ramachandran coach. I can see Krishnamurti. I can see Satinder Yadav of Kanpur. I can see Alkar Rani from Ghaziabad. We don't want your names now. We want to do education. So please, for God's sake, don't write your name. You just keep writing your names, which is of no relevance, and you're disturbing all the other students who are trying to learn. So I can't understand what to do. So from now, anybody who writes their name before the session is over, please remove them from the program. And do not mark their attendance, and please do not give them a certificate. I hope I'm very clear, Volker. Aap log aapka naam na likhe, haath jod ke aapse vinti hai. Main ye roj bol chuka hoon. Aapka naam likhne se koi fayda nahi hai. Chat sirf question answer ke liye hai. Aap jabhi session khatam ho, aap aapka naam likh ke attendance karke nikle. ये हमारी विनती है, हाथ जोड़ के विनती है, और जो ये मानने को नहीं तैयार है उनको उनका उनको निकाला जाएगा और उनको कोई सर्टिफिकेट नहीं दिया जाएगा, उसका अटेंडेंस नहीं मार्क किया जाएगा और आपकी रिपोर्ट डीजी साई के पास जाएगी. सो और ये एएफआई के पास जाएगी, डीजी साई के पास जाएगी, बिकॉज 800 लोग यदि ये करते रहेंगे तो कोई क्वेश्चन सब क्वेश्चन मिस हो जाएंगे. और हम यहाँ है एडुकेशन के लिए, इंटरेक्शन के लिए, सीखने के लिए. सो थैंक यू वेरी मच. हफीजुर रहमान, व्हाई यू राइटिंग योर नेम? आपका नाम क्यों लिख रहे हो? यू आर नॉट टू राइट योर नेम.
Okay, thank you very much. Please, coaches, refrain from posting your names. That will not help you at all. Yeah, the attendance will be taken after the class by SAI. And the same applies. We unfortunately are not able to provide you with any information regarding the registration for the exam, because also this is handled by SAI and not directly by the Athletics Association of India. But I can tell you that I've shared the link for all the presentations. Is you, yeah, it's indianathletics.in/study-materials-coach/again. Thank you very much, Mr. Adil Sumariwala. And today, for the first time, we have a very special guest from Indonesia. I think you all know Mr. Ria Lumintuazo. Before all these online courses started, he was a father of, I would say, coaches education in South Asia. He's a director of the former IAAF, now World Athletics Development Center, located in Jakarta. And I think there's not a single person in Asia which has conducted as many level 1, 2, and 3 coaches as Tim. Ria, welcome to our online session. It would be great if you were sharing a few words with us as well.
Thank you, Holger, for inviting me. And thank you also for Mr. Nair and Honorable Mr. Adil Sumariwala. So I think this is my first time to join your session, but I'm very glad to see that you are very can say proactive in the situation. I think the other country will try to follow also, but I think this is a very good idea to start in India with a big amount of coaches. I can see here 600 already joined. This community before also so many things. But we happy because in ADC we plan, but IAAF or World Athletic say that we can't with so many people. So maybe we will see how we can setting the course or the seminar like you in India. Thank you, Volker. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. I hope that you and your family are doing well. I always follow your videos, your posting regarding the health. That's a great initiative as well. Yeah. Also, special thanks to Mr. Bahadur, our chief coach, for joining. And we have a couple of former Indian top athletes who are coaching now. So it's really great to see that again, we have more than 600 coaches. I'm pretty sure within the next minutes, the number will raise to over 700. But we should not waste too much time. We don't want to waste too much time of your weekend because you need some recovery as well. So I kindly request Mr. Radhakrishna, our deputy chief coach, to go ahead with his presentation. Thank you very much and enjoy listening.
Thank you, Volker. It is great to see Mr. Ria, Dr. Ria, in the session and welcome you. Thank you very much to join
us. Thank you.
I'm a little nervous because he was my teacher in many courses as well. We co-lectured 3 or 4 courses in India as well as in Indonesia. Thank you for joining. Today, of course, the session is not very, very specific, but it is quite specific for the coaches who started coaching. May not be that much referring to the coaches of, you can say, elite coaches, but definitely it will be helping us to, helping our new coaches, novice coaches, to develop the teaching skill and communication as well as skills of coaching. I combine this together because thinking that these all three are very much related. For example, if you don't have a good communication skill, you will not be able to teach a skill as well as your coaching skill also will not be that good. So I compared, I combine this all these three things, that is communication, that is also skill, and skill teaching and coaching skills. Let us go to the slides. As I said, it is very helpful for the novice coaches who started coaching right now, and we have about 560 level 1 coaches working around the country. As well, there are some level 2 coaches. So the skill of communication is the foundation of the basic skills of coaching and teaching skill. As I said in the beginning, that is the reason I just combine all this together. Otherwise, in our level 1 course, all these three are different classes. So it will be a little longer, but let us see how we can manage this within our time. Communication. Communication is a two-way process. That is exchanging the information, sending and receiving, as well as receiving and sending. So in our coaching In our coaching, it is very much effective if you, we, as I said in the beginning, if you don't have a good communication skill, you can't be a you can't be a good coach, a smart coach. And communication, like any other skill, it can be improved by practice. And it, we should improve this skill for better, for doing better coaching. There are two different communication. That is, you all know that that is, one is verbal communication. The other one is talking and listening. And the content is transferred by talking, and the information is getting received from your athlete or your, the one you are making communication, that is verbal communication. The other one is non-verbal communication. Of course, you all know that non-verbal communication is more effective during a competition, where a coach cannot go directly to him and communicate verbally. So non-verbal communication is another communication which we can do, that of course by the facial expression, your facial expression and tone of your voice, raising and lowering, and your cloth and appearance, it is most important, and body posture and body language. Verbal communication is a message between a speaker and sender and receiver. Both have to be attentive. That is most important. The sender as well as the receiver has to be attentive. Then only it will become a proper communication. Messages need to be clear, and it should be simple to understand. And verbal non-verbal communication, of course, it carries only 70% of information. Not as like a verbal communication, and it is being expressed through body language, emotions, and the way one speaks. There are effective communication skills. For to communicate, you need to gain the athlete's attention, and you should know how to use your voice. And it is like us, the situation requires. Then we have to develop non-verbal skills and listening skills. For gaining attention, you need to position the place where all the athletes can see you, and you have to divide into group, and the athlete has to see, athlete should be able to listen what you are transferring to them, as well the you should be able to listen what athlete is transferring to you. And voice can be controlled as loud, low, as I said, as required. So 10 minutes, conduct first information. For the first 10 seconds, is you can use it gaining the interest of a receiver, I mean the interest of your athletes. How can we do it? That you can do in different way, by clapping, saying hello, or using a whistle. First 10 seconds, you must gain the interest of the receiver. That means you should get the attention of the receiver. Effective speech is not loudness of speech. Most of our coaches, I too sometimes I speak very loudly, but that is not an effective communication. It doesn't carry sometimes the content and information. You should need to apply the different registration of all your voice according to situation, according to content. When you are explaining a very important content, sometimes you may raise your voice, and sometimes you may reduce your voice when to gain more attention from the athlete. Silence. When you pause, definitely the athletes will give more attention what you are going to talk. Then thumb inputs in skill teaching, it's a non-verbal communication. And then developing non-verbal communication. Developing non-verbal communication skill. Voice tone. Movements of your head, shoulder, arms, leg, whole body. Definitely, these are the non-verbal comment. How you are going to express your, how you are going to communicate to your athletes by using your head, head like that. Yes, understood. Shoulder, no. Arms, like this. Or legs, of course, an action of a shot putting. You can even communicate to your athlete during coaching by using your legs or your limbs. And the whole body also you can use. Like, for example, you are demonstrating you want to pass the information to a high jumper. You may use your whole body. And your cloth and appearance, most important. See, you can see a photograph. I can see one of my coach. This is a coaching course in Jakarta. You can find our Mr. Bhatia in that picture. Have you seen the coach demonstrating the skill with a full trouser and a shirt? Of course, his face is being covered because IAAF, or we don't want to show to the public who is that. So you need to have the clothes and appearance when you do the non-verbal communication. So how you develop active listening skills, it's very important for us to develop active listening skills. And you should be attentive when the athlete or the one who's sending you a message or giving you an information, avoid interpreting, show understanding, and asking questions for clarity. I have some small videos on this, but I was thinking of shooting with Mohanlal and Rajinikanth, but I could not find time enough. So I brought another Rajinikanth from Tamil Nadu and one Mohanlal from Kerala. So let us see the video so that then you will be able to understand more how you are going to communicate with your athlete or to someone else, to athlete parents, because communication as a coach, you have to communicate to your fellow coaches, you have to communicate to your athlete, you have to communicate to the parents of the athlete, you have to communicate to the administration. So let us see how it's going on. Have you seen this small video, the way the athlete or the person communicate to the another one and how attentive he is? He is not listening what he says. Of course, he is partially listening, but if you partially listening, you will not be able to come give a solution or to give a message back to him. So you may just see that this such type of communication is happening among our coaches. When an athlete is explaining his difficulty or his condition, he will not take care. He will be busy in attending telephone. In between, you please tell me. That this is also one way of communication, but that is, it is not at all an effective communication. Then second one. In this, you can find Mr. Nagesh is explaining the chance of 400 to 100 meter getting qualified for Olympics. But other coach, Mr. Rajmohan, he is hijacking in other way, telling that, no, it is not that important. Sometimes 400 to 400 mixed relay is already qualified, and we are expecting 400 to 400 men, women also to get qualified. So in this communication, what is happening? He's hijacking the communication sent by Nagesh while doing communication. He's hijacking. Some other way he's hacking. So, and he want to explain, he want to boost on thing, but he doesn't want to listen what he's telling. This is also you can see in with us, is he among us when we do communication? Then so in this, what you can find, Nagesh is communicating something, but he is not listening. He is interfering with another questions to him. So, 1 minute. You can see in this communication between Nagesh and Rajmohan, he is interrupting, he is not listening, and he is telling some other story when he was explaining about a certain important information, and he started interrupting and even giving judgment before completely listening. These also you can find among us when you communicate. Now, the other one, being very attentive, in this you can find Nagesh is acting an athlete and Rajmohan is our coach. He is attending completely what he is communicating, and Rajmohan is showing understanding what he says, and even he clarifies by asking questions. By all these four videos, we ourselves must assess how we do communication when in coaching or when you are teaching a skill. So we have to improve your listening skills, not to interrupt and not to hijack the communication, or not to give judgment before listening completely, and you need to be attentive and show your understanding by nodding your head or shoulder as well. You should ask questions to clarify for the clarity. So that now come convincing. For better communication, you need a convincing nature. I mean, you have to be accepted by the athletes, or they accepted by the society, or accepted by the other coaches. So there are some guidelines: knowledge of athletics, competency of you. Then talk only when necessary. Because if you talk more, sometimes the contents will be missed, and the one who receives the communication will be confused what to listen and what not to listen, and what is important and what is not important. So talk only when necessary and talk less, and appear professional. As I said in the beginning, dress, manner, way of living, ethics. This is very important with us. You know, if you are not an accepted person by the society, by the people, by the coaching society, by athletes, I think you will not be able to communicate, and you will not be able to convince an athlete or the fellow people about in coaching. So you need to appear professional. in a very good manner. You should dress according to the condition required. You must have seen when we conduct the level one courses, we used to come in track pants and t-shirt with shoes, we lecturers. The reason being, when we do the lecturing, we need to show you some demonstration as well. If a lecturer comes with a pant, tight jeans and a tight t-shirt, sometimes he or she will not be able to demonstrate as required. And way of living, it is very important. See, coaches has to have a different way of living than a normal individual. But someone may not agree with me, because like everyone, being a democratic country, you may ask me that I can live as I like. But as I said, to be acceptable, you may not be able to live like us. For example, it is not an example. It is an example, but don't get offended. Some of our fellow coaches or fellow participants don't get offended. You please, of course, there are many coaches use alcohol or having a habit of drinking alcohol. But have you seen a coach going to a beverage corporation or the place where you are buying liquor and standing in queue in India? But it is in India. But it is not an acceptable living of a coach. And you can't find a coach just after drinking or lost his whole conscience and sleeping on the footpath. So, and then ethics of athletics, ethics of coaching. Of course, it is a very big subject. I'm not going in detail. So you should have the ethics. You should respect athletes. You should respect fellow coaches. You should respect administration. You should respect officials. So these are the most convincing for the better communication. Now I'm just entering to the skill teaching. As I said in the beginning, communication skill is very essential to teach a skill. Skill teaching, I'm just talking generally. Observe the athlete's skill several times and look for correct moves done at the correct time. Little visible effort, physiologically efficient, unhurried, highly coordinated action, capable of speed and accuracy, consistency and smooth movements. We are going in detail in the coming slides, so I'm not going much on this slide. So the skill teaching, when you teach a skill, we have to observe the following thing, which then you can identify about the skill learning. What level the athlete has learned the skill. So let me go to the next slide. Techniques are the basic building blocks of skill performance. Otherwise, you can call simply the most efficient way of solving a physical task, whether it is high jump or something else, like lifting a heavy weight or lifting a stone, whatever it may be, to solve a physical task, the most efficient way of solving a physical task. Can we copy the technique of champions? Many do that. Many of my friend coaches, they download the technical model of champions, like for example, a good shot putter or good hammer thrower, and they try to put into practice of our athletes. Will you all agree that the champions technique is the best technique? But I do not. For example, the 200 meter, 400 meter champion, Michael Johnson, his technique of running is totally against the biomechanical principles. So can we say that Michael Johnson had a good technique? The technique depends upon the many factors. As I said, the most efficient way of solving a physical task, as you know that athletes are unique with different abilities. Somebody may be having good speed, someone will be having a very good explosive strength, someone will be having good flexibility, the other one will not be having. So we will not be able to have the same technical model, but the technique is the most efficient way of solving tasks with the help of applied biomechanics. So there are three different stages of skill learning. We should understand about all these three stages. You can connect with this our athlete development. The very first day, Mr. Volker Herman has a very detailed class of athlete development. You can connect it. Beginning stage. What is the stage, beginning stage, as athlete development compared? You can say the youth stage, 13 to 15, that is the beginning stage. In the stage, their athletes are thinking to do what, how to do. And we are giving demonstration and asking them to do and working out what to do. But here you make sure that you should teach the simplest way of teaching a skill. Not to go to the developed teaching stages. They should understand what they should do. And you can, in this stage, they can have a model of a rough form of a skill. Not, you can say, a very good form of skill. If you are trying to do that, you are specializing the athlete in early stage. What we are facing now. Then come intermediate stage. How you connect with the development, athlete development? That is from 16 to 20. In this stage, we can call it as a learning stage. They are practicing and they are trying out ways of doing it. And they are making the skill already learned to the, because you can use the intermediate stage as a cue for the already learned skill in the beginning stage. Here, a lot of practice, learning by doing. And other one is advanced stage, the performing the skill. In this stage, they will be able to appear in a competition situations, and they himself will be able to analyze the skill, whether he has done it or not, because a kinesthetic feedback, they feel that yes, after throwing javelin, he feel himself that my shoulder was not kept behind, my javelin was dropping, I just lifted my javelin up while releasing. So the kinesthetic will be that they will be able to understand themselves, and they can get a kinesthetic feedback from in this stage. And you can say it is not a stage where the skill is completely mastered. It takes time. They are mastering. But so in this stage can be connected with your performance stage in the athlete development. Beginning stage, the coach briefly talking about the skill to be learned in a simple way, demonstrating and explaining the skill in a simple way, and using a teaching method that allows the beginner to perform the skill well enough to begin practicing. Don't give him a complex method of skill teaching so that the athlete will not be able to practice it. So simplify. And in our teaching progression, we have different stages of teaching a skill. So if we follow, definitely they will be able to get into the intermediate stage in a better way and later in the performance stage. Intermediate stage is developed by regular practice, and we are enriching the motor program that was initiated in the beginning stage. As I said, it is a cue in the intermediate stage. What they have already learned, up to where they learned. And from there, you are initiating the beginning of the next stage. Learning by doing, motor density to be organized by coach. Learning by doing, you should organize motor density. What is motor density? Motor density is number of repetitions. With different way, with different equipment, whatever it may be. So motor density means more number of practice, and it should be organized by the coach because they are doing it by doing, learning by doing. I think I have spoke about myelin sheath. In this area, I'm not explaining much about that. In anatomy, I explained a little bit about myelin sheath. It helps the myelinization of the nerves, and they will be getting more automized on that movement. athlete need to be motivated to learn. So when they do perform, you have to motivate him, rather than this is not good, that is no, you are not able to perform. I think it is very difficult for you to do this particular skill. Better you change your, even like I heard many coaches suggest such. So in place of that, you should motivate them to learn by telling, yes, this is now it is very good. You are doing it a better way. You, if you do it the same way and do it once again, and you feel it, you do it same way in the next time and do once again and practice. So you have to motivate to learn, and you have to motivate him to practice more to know if what they are doing is correct. See, that is what I said. You talk, speak more about what they are doing correct and less about what they are doing not correct. And you must give a correct feedback. There is no set timetable for the intermediate stage. You cannot make a set timetable for an intermediate stage. For example, a complex skill may be learned by sometime years, 2 years or 3 years, but maybe a simple skill be not mastered, learned by 4 or 5 months or 6 months or 7 months. So there is no set timetable. Don't fix, okay, by next year you will be learning the skill, or you don't fix a timetable for that. This is advanced stage. I briefly explained the beginning still. Athletes are able to maintain high level performance, and they are able to appear in variation of competition like environments, and they'll be having a good understanding and feel their skill, inner eye, kinesthetic feedback by themselves, are able to evaluate themselves more effectively, are confident of performing a particular skill. But it doesn't mean that he has mastered the skill in even in the advanced stage. A summary about the learning or skill learning. Process of learning cannot be seen directly. How you will understand the process of learning, how you will evaluate is learning the skill. It can be observed by changing in the skill performance, and definitely in competition, an improved skill will give you an improved, give them an improved performance. Skill learning is a continuous process of 3 stages, as we said. We already referred beginning, intermediate, and advanced. Learning a new skill involves combining previously learned movement patterns with new movement patterns. I said in the intermediate stage, what they are already learned in the beginning stage to be combined. Until and unless, if you don't perform the first stage, for example, in short put, if one is not able to deliver properly, if one is not to hold the shot properly and deliver properly from a power position, then there is no fun of teaching him momentum building, whether it is by rotation or by a linear moment, by a glide. We must get the other 2 stages, then other 2 stages, we should allow them to learn the first 2 stages, then go to the next stage. The main concern of teaching during the beginning stage is to communicate in general terms how to perform the new skill, such that motor program may begin to develop. Already explained on this, the main concern of teaching during the intermediate stage of learning to structure practice condition and provide feedback that assists development of the motor program. What is motor program? Motor program is quality feedback, motor density plus quality feedback is a motor program. I think you understood this. Most of my level one coaches are very clear about this. We generally take this terminology frequently in the throughout course. Neuronal variability. Again, as I said, the myelinization. If you number of time, if you practice with different situation, like reducing the height of the hurdle, or using a box jumping, or using medicine balls, even iron balls for throws. So different doing different activity for many times will improvise, improve your myelination, and they will be automatic. That means they will be getting fast information from brain to muscle to act upon. Motor density, learning by doing, that is motor density. Athlete proceed through the intermediate stage of learning, developing a feeling of the correctly performed skill. As I said, it's a rough form, but correctly performed skill in the beginning stage, and they will be learning further. The main concern of teaching during the advanced stage is designing effective practice conditions. You have to plan effective practice conditions. It is not that if you come in the morning and say that today, how do you feel? Okay, we can go for this, or according to the athlete choice, sometimes you yourself will not be having any plan with you. So you need to plan for teaching advanced stage. Designing effective practice conditions, motivating athletes to continue to learn. Reaching the advanced stage of learning does not mean that skill learning is finished. I asked, already told, but it is continuously. Limits are being approached, and that learning must continue if limits are to be approached. The learning should be continuous. We should not take confirm that in the advanced stage, the athletes are learned the skill. Now, there are simple sports skills and complex sports skills. Simple sports skills are an individual can perform with very little practice, usually a result of the simplicity of the skill. And complex skills are little difficult skill to perform with very little practice. It may take longer time. As I said in the beginning, in the intermediate stage, there is no time level. It may take sometimes 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. Usually, and it depends upon the physiological efficiency of the athlete. And approximately 80% of learning through what is seen. The simple skills have been taught 80% through what is seen. That means need for a technical correct demonstration by coach. Of course, I will come in detail about demonstration in the coming slides. So we need to demonstrate correct demonstration is required in the beginning stage or in the simple sports when you're teaching simple sports skills. What appears simple for you may be complex for others. This also, there is in my days when I was doing level one, there was a question that triple jump is always a complex skill, true or false. But the answer for this is this, that what it appear for, what skill is simple for me may be complex for others. As I said, it is all depend upon the physical abilities, motor skills. So, or by neuronal variability. Two approach commonly used in teaching simple skill, that is imitation method, demonstration, explanation, practice method. It's almost same, but let us see. Imitation method, simple imitation is often the best way to learn. It requires correct demonstration by the coach. It is very much required that correct demonstration. It doesn't happen with many of our coaches because many of the coaches will not be able to demonstrate all the athletic event in a perfect manner. So how do we do that? We'll go in the next slides. When the demonstration comes, I'll explain more. The athlete to focus what is to be imitated or copied. You must make sure that athlete is focusing what is to be imitated or copied in a particular demonstration. You should ask, watch this, try it. If the imitation accurates, this should be confirmed. Yes, that is it. Now remember that feeling and practice it. This is another way you are motivating the athlete to learn. And after demonstrating, you can ask them, you want to see it again or you want to try? When they perform, you should say, if it is somewhat correct, yes, that is it. Now remember that feeling and practice it. When minor corrections are required, point them out in a clear way. Then demonstration, explanation, and practice and correction method. Demonstration, as I said, with a brief explanation. Don't explain much. If you explain much, they will not be able to understand what is most important and what is less important. Allow them time for practice. Observe carefully. You give them number of repetition. You allow giving them time to practice. Observe carefully, looking for correct action and common errors. As I said, the correct you need to observe for correct action as well as for the wrong action. But you more emphasis should be made on the correct action and common errors. For example, you have six shot putters. Most of them have a error in their power position or placing the leg in the power position. So you should focus on the common error. Then it will be easy for you to impart a skill or teach a skill. Provide feedback while practice continues. If it is necessary, stop practice and confirm correct actions. Make suggestion to correct errors. You need to make suggestion for correcting errors. Allow further practice. If needed, correct and modify. So simple skill learning is a continuous process. Demonstration, explanation, practice, confirm correct parts, identify errors, correct it, and again demonstration, explanation, practice, confirm, and this is a cycle. And then the methods of complex skill teaching. Complex skills are the actions, movements that an individual cannot easily learn by method used for simple skills. A competent coach is able to evaluate the beginner athlete, and we should evaluate what he has learned from the previous stage and what all the motor abilities, physical abilities of an athlete, and then simplify the skill to their level. We need to simplify the skill to their level. There are two type of teaching complex skills. One is shaping, other one is chaining. Of course, during the class of fundamental throws, I said the shot put is being taught in chaining, and I told you that we will go in detail in the coming class. Chaining is shaping and chaining. What is shaping? Make the whole action simpler. For example, a sculpture has got molding, a matka or whatever it may be. They are having something without having any shape. So making the whole action simpler by modifying into different way. For example, hurdle sprinting. How do we start hurdle sprinting, teaching the hurdle sprinting? We used to keep sticks to teach hurdle sprint rhythm. Sticks in a different distance, like 5 meter or 3 meter difference, and we will ask our athlete to run through and making sure that they are not jumping over it. Then further, we are improving the height of the sticks to a moderate way. Then further, we are putting a hurdle, and we are doing with side hurdling and lead leg action and trail leg action. Then getting to the whole skill after they get mastered each stage. You know, we should make sure do the next stage after the athlete is able to perform the previous stage. For example, if the athlete is not able to do the trail leg and the lead leg action, you should not put him to the full hurdling action. After he is getting an idea of, after getting the skill of lead leg and trail leg action, then we can start using whole hurdle with less distance, then improve the distance, then go with whole actions. as I reminded in the beginning, it's all according to the athlete's development. Don't try to make an hurdler by 15 winning, running full hurdling with 100 meter or what, 110 meter or whatever maybe. And what is chaining? Breaking the whole skill to a different part. Breaking the whole skill to a different part, different skills. For example, teaching short foot. We are breaking the whole skill in different part, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. For example, what we should teach first, we should decide. It is not that straight away start teaching them the glide. The most difficult one. So what is the most important? What important is delivery. So first, make him to hold the shot, fixing the shot, then delivering from front position and sideward, even from power position. Then when he gets into that, then we can introduce momentum building, otherwise a glide or a rotation. That is a way of teaching short put. First part and practice it. First two part and practice it. First three part and practice this. And then all this part, you can make it together and to get into the whole skill of shot putting. Demonstration. In the beginning slide, I said we'll speak a little more about demonstration in the coming slide. Decide the purpose and type of demonstration. Before you start demonstrating, I know, and it is not possible for every coach to perform or demonstrate every athletic skill. Then what we should do? We have to take, of course, we can take a video, but it is not that practicable at all times. Of course, it may give a correct technical model, but you cannot show him from different direction because the particular video may be only from one direction. So when you demonstrate, you need to demonstrate from different action, different sides and different angles so that the athlete will understand. If you are not able to demonstrate, please don't demonstrate it at all. You take help of another coach who is able to demonstrate the particular skill in a proper way. Otherwise, you can even use a senior athlete to demonstrate it. But whatever it may be, the best demonstration will be the best way to demonstrate is by itself, because the novice athlete will have more respect towards you, that my coach is able to demonstrate that skill in a very proper way. That is making appreciation on them. They are getting, you are getting appreciated by them. But if there is no other way, we have to depend upon the other type of demonstration. And while demonstrating, as I said, your position should be all should be clear, and all the participants will be able to see you and able to hear you. Focus on one or two key points. When you demonstrate, don't focus on more number of points. For example, when you are teaching a skill of shot putting, what is the most important key point? It is power position and delivery. So when we teach skill, we should focus one or two key points and demonstrate. Silent demonstration repeated several times from several directions. Ask, would you like to try that? To see it again. Then about the feedback. We already demonstrated. After that, we allowed them to practice. Now feedback. Naturally available feedback from within athlete as a result of making a movement. There are two types, intrinsic feedback and extrinsic feedback. That is one is inner eye, that is kinesthetic feedback. It is always present for the athlete, but they may not always be aware of it. Please mind this intrinsic feedback. Of course, for the beginner athlete, it is very difficult for them because they are not much aware about the skill and they are not that developed. But of course, the elite athlete can have this intrinsic feedback. other additional feedback to the athlete by external sources, and it can be even called as extrinsic feedback, which is from coach, from other athletes, spectators, and mirrors. You can get a feedback during competition. Your fellow athlete may be giving you feedback, and after the competition, a spectator like a coach, fellow coach, or somebody else can give you feedback. And mainly the feedback is being given by coach. And video replay, of course, after the competition, you can have a video replay, or after training session, you can have a video replay and get feedback. As I said, this feedback sometimes referred as extrinsic feedback. When you're providing feedback, observe several times before giving feedback. And a quality feedback. Motor density plus quality feedback is a motor program. So, what do you understand by quality feedback? I've seen some coaches, they say, very good. Oh, it was good. Oh, it was very good. I heard from some coaches that always he's telling, very good, very good, very good, very good. Is it a quality feedback? No, it is not a quality feedback. Quality feedback is the feedback which necessary, some of the good points as well as some of the wrong points. Identify and reinforce what the athlete did correctly. As I said, it motivates learning. Identify and reinforce what athlete did correctly. Ask question to raise self-awareness. You can ask, how do you felt? How was your right leg in the center this time? So, to make them self-aware, you can ask questions during while feedback. Limit one or two key important points. When you give feedback, limit one or two key important points. That is very important, because if you find some error and maybe many errors, so you have to focus on one or two key points. So don't say that your hand was up, your shoulder was down, your leg was not properly placed in center, your hip was not acted properly during shot putting. So limit one or two key important points. For example, as I said in the beginning, important points, of course, the delivery or the right leg position in the center or the left leg opening, etc. So limit one or two key important points. Keep it positive. It doesn't mean that you can give negative feedback as well, but most of the, you keep it positive. That is very important. Okay. Now we are entering the skills of coaching. What is coaching? Of course, now we are coming to the next days. Mr. Volker and me will be having some planning and periodization, etc. And coaching is planning and doing what you have planned. Please remember, doing what you have planned, and then after doing, reviewing it. It is a continuous process. Planning and doing what you have planned, reviewing, and reviewing what you have done. In the second part, most of our coaches are interested in doing, but many doesn't plan. Please don't get offended. It is my experience with even the national elite level coaches. They don't do plan, and they are doing, but they are not doing what they plan. Or if at all, they don't plan. And then review, of course, everyone does. So this is the skills of coaching. These are the skills of coaching. It's a process. Skills of coaching. This is a process. Now, there are five skills of coaching. Five basic skills. One is build and develop the relationship. Second one is provide instruction and explanation. Provide demonstration. Observe and analyze. Provide feedback. As well, the most important, in the center of your palm, the coaching hand, that is safe. Safety, safe environment. This is, I believe, this is the most important skill of a coach to ensure always the coach should always create a safe environment. Otherwise, as I said in the fundamental throws day, you may kill a potential. I had an experience I don't want to explain again. Even while doing weight training, if you don't create a safe environment, the athlete can be fully paralyzed in the throughout life. So safety is the most important factor. If a coach doesn't assure the safety environment, I don't consider him as a coach. What I said, you must not. You are going to kill an athlete, or you are going to perish an athlete by you are not making sure the safe environment. So that is the most important of in. You can say skill, but you cannot say skill. Among the five skills of coaching, most important I feel, creating a safe environment of practice, or even for the competition. Now let us come to the first point. First skill, that is build and develop relationship. For that, first of all, you should be confident as a coach in front of your athletes. How you can be confident? There was a question to Miss Galina during the principle of training. One coach asked, one athlete has come to me, but she left after 2 months to back to her coach. Why it is happening? You need to develop a relationship. So you have to be confident as coach in front of your athletes. For that, you need competency. You must have the knowledge of athletics. Then only you can be confident, and then only you'll be accepted by your athlete. Then only you can build and develop a good relationship with the athletes. And it is very important to be confident as in front of your athletes, and your confidence only occur if you're competent. Smile and make eye contact. Always keep a smile, but generally I don't keep. I'm sorry because it is my behavior. But you may please keep a smile and make eye contact. Then athlete feel very easy than when you in a very angry mood or some mood which doesn't accept by small children. Especially these all is related to novice coaches. And have eye contact. Of course, I've seen one coach is coaching with sunglasses. Yes, in summer you may use a sunglass, but when you talk to an athlete, you remove your sunglass and talk. You don't need to wear, though it is very hot, you should remove your sunglass and then you talk to them. Then you can have more interaction with the athlete. Even I am suffering, I'm having a problem during a Zoom session because I'm not able to look to the eyes of the participants. So simple, smile and make eye contact and show interest in respect of each athlete. It's also happening with us. It unknowingly happens. There are athletes are not unique. There are some athletes will be having better physical and physiological abilities and is able to learn faster. The level 2 coaching, higher level coaching classes, there was a question from a coach, how can you make a slow learner to fast learner? So I too agree that if you have a group of athletes of 20, it is quite big, 20 athletes, you should show interest in all in the same way. Don't have a partiality by thinking that he is son of Radhakrishnan, so he should be given more attention. Or he is son of Rajmohan, so he should be given more attention. Or he is coming from a very rich family, he should be given more attention. So there should not be any difference of interest. You should show interest in each and everyone similarly. And respect for each athlete. In the coaching philosophy, we already gone through athlete-centered. So we have to respect each and everyone, every athlete in a similar way and give them all importance. Don't be partial. But I'm sure that some of the coaches will have little bit interest towards one or two highly talented athletes, but please don't show it. It may definitely for the younger group, youth group. The other athlete will have an ill feeling and they will feel jealous on him, and you will not be able to maintain a good relation with them. You will not be able to maintain a relation between them, each other. And then other one is use athlete name. I remember my days, most of the time I never been called by any, hey, and otherwise use some other name. Oh, Lembu, oh, Chotu, something like that. Even some coaches I know, they will not use anything like, and they use very bad abusive words. But the days have gone now. Nowadays it will not work. You can't practice that. The athlete will leave you. Athlete will not train with you. So you must know their names. Of course, if you are continuously training in a group, but if you transfer from one place to another place, or to one scheme to another scheme, you will not be able to remember their names. So it is better to ask them to wear a name tag for 2 or 3 days. It is not that you should be able to learn the names by 2 or 3 days. It is not that you will be asking them to wear their name tag for throughout the course of training. Then you can learn their names, then you can use their name and you can call them by names. The athlete feel very proud when you call them by names and they feel very comfortable. Then coach the athlete rather than coach athletics. That also has been clearly explained in the class of the philosophy of coaching. Coach athlete considering his needs and his efficiency. Athletes are not unique. Don't coach athletics. Again, you can see in the center of your coaching hand, safety. Now, second point, that is provide instruction and explanation. Here also, think about what you are going to say when you are providing instruction and explanation. You should make sure that what you are going to say today, that for that you need a good plan, what you are going to do, what you are planning to do, right? Then gain attention. As I said, you need to gain 10 seconds will be used for gaining attention. I told in the beginning that gaining attention, 10 seconds you must use for gaining attention. And after that, you can start instruction and explain. Keep it simple. Kiss. Keep it simple. Don't try to show your terminology or language. You should keep it simple so that when you provide instruction and explanation, the athletes in front of you should understand what you want them to do. And then group athletes according to the numbers, ability and activity. You need to group the athletes. If you have a very big group, as yesterday Mr. Walker shown a video of about 50, 60 students, definitely a physical education teachers, coaching in schools, it is normally it happens. And you need to group the athletes according to the number. Suppose there are 50, you can divide into 10, 10 each or 15 each. Then when you group, make sure according to the ability and activity. Ability means activity means what they are going to do. Right? And check for understanding by asking questions. Right? Then providing demonstration. This is also one of the basic skill of coaching. Basic skill of a coach. Decide the purpose and type of demonstration. What type of demonstration are you going to do? I already explained a little bit about it. And please don't demonstrate if you are not having the correct technical model of the particular skill. But trying to do it, mostly the young athletes, I mean youth athletes, they will learn by seeing. So something you are demonstrating wrong, and that will be in their mind, and they will be practicing it. And when they go to the next stage, to another coach, the another coach will have a lot of difficulty to change the particular hill from to the original one. And you should position to, you should take such a position that all can see and hear whatever you are showing and whatever you are talking. As I said, focus on one or two key points already explained. Silent demo repeated several times from several directions. Silent demonstration is better and should be, you should repeat from several times and from several directions. Then you should ask, you want to see it again or you want to try? If they say I want to see it again, then you can again demonstrate and then ask them to practice it. Ask, would you like to try or would you like to see it again? Again, safety. Safety is the most important thing when you provide demonstration as well. Observe and analysis. Then we learned about skill teaching. We said observation and analysis. That is most important area of skill teaching as well as one of the most important coaching skills. You should break the action down into phases so that you will be able to observe and analyze what you are going to analyze, what you are going to observe. Then observe several times from several directions. Don't stand in one place and start observing the huddler. You need to go to different direction. You need to go to the, for example, when you are observing a javelin throw, you may have to go to the sector area, you may have to go to the rear part, you may have to come to the right. Then only we will be able to observe very proper way. And then compare with your technical model of the action or the skill done by your athlete and identify what is correct as well as what is incorrect. And decide what action to take, if any. Suppose if you found, if you observed something incorrect, you need to suggest or you need to give a correction drill to correct it. It is that very easy for anyone to observe. If you have a coach's eye, this you can say otherwise coach's eye. If you are a coach's eye, you can observe, okay, the right leg action, this, and I'm sorry, I'm always referring with throws because I'm a throwing coach basically. Right leg action is not fast, but you should know why it is not fast, how you can make it fast. These are the things which you need to do after observation and analyzing a technical model of your athlete. The last, but the not least, and the most important. When you are giving feedback, you need to observe several times before giving feedback. You need to observe from many directions, as I said, and identify and reinforce what athlete did correctly. That motivates the athlete to learn more than you should not reinforce. But of course, you have to inform what you have done incorrect, but mainly reinforce and explain what the athlete did correctly. Ask question to raise self-awareness. As I already told, when I already have a brief explanation about feedback and limit to one or two key important points. Don't give so many mistakes which you found. This was not right, that was not right, this was not right. So you need to be one or two, the key important points. And again, keep it positive. And safety, that is most important. This is one of our coach giving a brief explanation and feedback after completion of a training session. This is our coach Galina with the 400 meter group. I think it is finished. Thank you very much for listening. I hope that there was some information for you all of last 56 minute lecturing. I'm sure that you will be having questions. Of course, it is not a specific subject and the participation also was not much today because every participant that chooses and they select which session is good and which session will be helpful for me. But definitely this will be helpful for the novice and the coaches start coaching. Thank you very much once again. Now to Mr. Volker or Rajmohan, any question from participants?
Yeah, thank you very much. I think that was a very informative session. A lot of knowledge we've gained, especially regarding the communication. There was one question, maybe you can elaborate a bit more on that. What is the difference between a skill and a technique?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. I think you are not seen the first slide of technique. Skills are the building block of techniques. So many skills form a technique. It is not one technique have many skills, different skills. So I can explain you to this limit. A skill is the building block. Many skills form a technique. And technique and skill, in one technique, there will be many skills. I think you are happy with my answer, or Mr. Volker, Herman, you like to add something?
No, I 100% agree. We just have heard this question from a couple of participants. In general, I think the skill is only the ability to perform a certain technique. Yeah, and that's the reason why the quality of your technique, especially when we're talking about advanced technical models or fine model or mastery, they depend on the quality of your motor skills as well. Yeah, and that's the reason why with younger athletes in particular, we have to conduct a lot of balance, rhythm, and coordination training in general. And there was one other question. Is it okay to conduct drills or motor skill training with children below the age of 8?
Motor skill, of course. I used to ask a question, when the physical literacy starts. We can't just say that motor skill, physical literacy starts from the by birth. For example, a child after getting birth, it started rolling upward side, then slowly crawling, then the child will try to sit, and then later they try to hold and stand, then they try to walk. We are not reaching these abilities to them. This naturally they are getting it. So I can't say that also is a motor ability to move. I can't say it is a motor ability, it is a physical literacy. So motor ability is what you are expecting from the motor ability word mean. I'm not clear whether it is you are intending to develop strength or develop endurance or develop speed. I suggest if you are thinking of it, it is somewhat automatically being learned. You don't need to push them. You don't need some exercise. Will you try to hold your child and make them to walk? If you are doing it, I say it is wrong, because you are stopping the. I mean, you are not allowing the strength to improving the strength level of the legs. So it is. I don't know what you are thinking of motor skills. Generally, when you go for 8 to 12, that is kids athletic stage, there are some motor skills have been developed. Of course, there is no particular training for that. By doing a lot of fun activities, they are developing some strength, some speed, some coordination, and coordination abilities. And later, we are purifying it and we are giving more exercises in the next stage. Hope it is satisfied and make it sense.
Yeah, I fully agree with you. Yeah, so there is no limit for motor skills, and again, motor skills usually describes the coordinative abilities, and that's something you have to, or you can actually start training very shortly after the babies have been born, that you pass them some balls or whatever to play around. So this is all helping to improve the ability of our motor skills. Yeah. There was one more question. Let's see. Yeah. Maybe Mr. Radhakrishnan, is there any difference in the communication towards younger and older athletes, especially when they're training in the same group?
Yeah, there definitely there is. Because as I said in the beginning in our slides, when you communicate to younger athletes, it is much different. Much different. Because you have to create an attention and you have to create an interest to listen to you. Generally, you also see that when you have about 15, 20 children, even though you gain their attention, they will not be willing to listen to you. And you should be competent. And definitely, you should look into their eyes. I told you there are some certain things like building a relation. When you have a good relation with the athlete, they definitely will listen to you and they will take care, they will listen to you, and you should also listen to them. And it should be a soft mother. It's not that strict as like what communication skill says, but it is exactly communication skill says. That is what I said. It is very helpful for the novice coaches who are looking after the younger group of 15, 14, 13. It is very difficult to communicate them and to get information from them. It is your efficiency to do that. But in elite athletes, the communication also have a big role, but it is not as same like younger athletes. Okay, is it okay?
Yeah, sure. There's one additional question regarding the shaping and sustaining methods. Are there certain events where you prefer the shaping and other events where you prefer the shaining, or are both applicable all events?
It's a very good question, because I said two examples. It is up to the coach whether you should follow a chaining method or a shaping method. If the skill is more complex and if the learning ability of your athlete, as I said, there is no fixed timetable for learning a particular skill, a complex skill. So you can modify, you can shape. For example, teaching journey, you can shape, you can do it by shaping. By using some small balls or like a rubber javelin. So it is up to you, coach, to decide which method you like to do for teaching skills. It considering the ability of the athlete. Always know that athletes are unique. And you should not have the same teaching method to two different athletes. Is it okay?
Yes, definitely. For example, in an event where we need a flow of the movement, like in the hurdles, that's where we usually apply the shaping method, yeah? And in other events where, for example, in the throws, that we usually start with a shaping method. And always, I think we've mentioned this earlier, start with the main acceleration phase of the movement. Yeah? That might be the power position, or it might be the takeoff and the jumps. So that's usually the way to improve. Yeah, and once you have a decent technical model, then you're starting to increase the speed. So always follow these principles from slow to fast. And once again, I want to clarify the difference between skills and technique, because there's still some confusion. And coaches, you have to be very careful with that. A skill describes your coordinative abilities. Yeah, how are you able to develop a technique? Because technique just describes how you are executing a specific movement. But the quality of your technique depends on the quality of your skills. And the skill is, for example, rhythm or hand-eye coordination, reaction, yeah, balance. These are motor skills we have to develop. And only if you have a decent level of motor skills, you can go ahead teaching a technique. It's like, imagine you want to cook a dal, yeah, then you have a recipe, obviously, for doing that. And this recipe describes your technique. But the different ingredients are all the skills you have. Yeah, and you need a decent skill set. You need all the ingredients to optimize your recipe or even to apply it. Yeah, otherwise it probably won't taste. So skills and technique is something you definitely have to separate from each other. Yeah, the skills are more general and they are just the fundament of your technique. So the skills are enabling you to learn or to improve a certain technique. But it's definitely not the same. Yeah, the skills only make the movement available. And then the technique is the way how you're executing it. And it has nothing to do with a degree of perfection. Definitely not.
Thank you, Volker.
Yeah, there's an interesting question. Maybe Mr. Radhakrishnan, you can answer this. During a talent identification, how important are skill assessments, especially for the younger kids?
It is interesting as well as I feel little difficult to answer. In talent identification, definitely, as now Mr. Volker explained, what is skill and what is technique. Of course, we will not be much bothering about the technique, but definitely we have to assess the skill of an athlete when you identify for a particular event. When if you are talking about the raw talent identification, it's different. But for example, from the youth stage, when we are specializing in event, we will definitely look into the specific skill required for a particular event. For example, as he said, coordination, strength, speed, all together. For all event, it is very much required. But for example, technique of shot putting is not that difficult technique to master or to get perfect. But hammer throwing is difficult. And it is a complex skill. It is a complex skill. So that is what I want to say, but I think Volker can add some more.
As Mr. Radhakrishnan mentioned, it's relatively hard to measure these skills. And maybe that's related to another question which has been raised as well. Because when we're talking about skills, you know, it's we don't necessarily want to evaluate them. For us, it's more important to constantly approach them in training. So we have to constantly challenge our athletes regarding the skills. Yeah, and the skill might be balance. And again, a skill is the ability to perform a certain movement. Yeah, and that of course depends on the quality of your motor skills. So especially with the talents, the younger athletes, we have to develop these motor skills. And that's a process which is lasting throughout an athlete's career. And if you do that, let's say you want to develop balance, yeah, because balance becomes a limiting factor when it comes to our techniques. Yeah, because in athletics, most of the movements are single leg movements. And if you're standing on a single leg, that directly requires a certain amount of balance. So if you want to train balance as a skill, you probably start asking your athletes to stand only on one foot and to raise the opposite leg. Yeah, this might be a very easy to conduct exercise in the beginning. So maybe 80% of your athletes won't have any problem with that, 20 are still struggling. So you give more time to the struggling athletes, but the 80% who are doing it well, then you try to make it more difficult. Yeah? Instead of telling them, okay, you're just standing on one leg, you tell them, okay, you stand on one leg and you have to catch a medicine ball, for example. Yeah. So we always try to get our athletes out of their comfort zone. If this is getting too easy, you ask them to close their eyes, yeah, or you ask them to do the same exercise in a sand pit, at an unstable underground, or even on a balance pad, something like that. Yeah, so we constantly have to increase the complexity of these exercises, and there is no end towards the skill development. Yeah, and as better your skills are, as easier again will it be for your athletes to develop a decent technique or to excel in their technical development. But as Mr. Radhakrishna mentioned, it's almost impossible to measure the qualities. There are certain tests where, for example, you're standing with one foot on a balance board, and at the same time, you have to, on this board, there's, for example, a small labyrinth, yeah, and you have to get a ball through this labyrinth just by the control of your feet. That's one test, but again, it's not that easy to conduct. And even if you know about the test results, it does not really help you, because for us, especially when we're talking about talents, it's not in every talent identification, that has to be clear. Yeah, talent identification should not be about the performance of an athlete. A talent identification should always test the potential of an athlete. Because if you conduct a talent identification test at the age of 15 years, yeah, you might have an athlete who's training 2 times a week and you have another athlete who's training 8 times a week. If they're running the same time, you're going to select both, but you know that this athlete who's only training 2 times a week to jump 6.50 meters has a much higher potential than the athlete who's training 8 times a week and jumping the same distance. Yeah, so by testing our talents, you always have to look for the potential and not for the performance. And interestingly, if you have an athlete who is very good in this motor skills or coordination, often they have also slightly bigger potential. So maybe keep that in mind.
Thanks, Volker. Do we have any more questions?
Raj Mohan or Nagesh, something from your side?
Sir, one question is there. You already explained it. What is motor density? Is it different from number of repetitions? And what is motor program? They're having still doubt in this motor density and motor program.
I think I have to answer in Hindi, because in English, of course, I'm not very good in English, neither very good in Hindi. I explained that motor density is learning by doing. Doing number of times, practicing. Practicing means perfect practice. Not practicing never make you perfect. Perfect practice make you perfect and permanent. So doing more number, you are giving chance to perform a particular activity more number of times. I said it helps in neuronal variability as well as learning. And motor program is motor density with quality feedback. Motor density, you understood now. Motor density is doing many times, giving more, allowing more number of practice, plus quality feedback. Quality feedback also, I said, the feedback should not be yes or no, good, good, well done, well done, well done. It should be a quality feedback explaining the positive, the things done correctly, as well as the error, and with one or two key points, as I said, about feedback. I think it makes sense, and it's all right.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I think the questions are over.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you all. And thank you all participants. I know that it was not a specific session like what we had the previous days, the general session. Of course, and I again tell you this, I'm telling that this will help the novice coaches and the coaches started coaching. So you have to develop all these skills, communication skill and coaching skill, as well as how to teach a skill. So thank you once again. Thank you, Volker. I think Mr. Advocate Abdul Rakib is always with us from the day one. I like to have a small brief feedback of our program. I think, Volker, it will be all right now?
Yes, definitely, of course.
Okay, I invite Advocate Abdul Rakib Mundu, Secretary General of Bangladesh. He's very much interested in this coaches education, online coaches education. And thank you for attending regularly with us. If you can give a brief feedback of this session till day, you may please.
I'm right. Hello,
I'm calling you for giving you a brief introduction. I unmuted you. Mundu Saab, can you hear me? You are online and you are unmuted. Advocate Abur Rokib for giving a brief feedback on this online session. Hello?
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Good morning, Naishab, and welcome, Bholkar. How are you?
You're all fine. And we just good want session, a feedback good from session. You.
I'm sorry, actually sound a little bit low, that's why I'm not hearing, but it's okay. Our participant and all participants, I especially thanks to the this present situation, conduct this course and program. We are very happy right now, and especially thanks our in Athletes Federation of India, Mr. Adil, and also Dr. Lalit K. Bhanot, all of the staff of Athletes Federation of India, also conduct this session, Nair Shaib and Bholkar, and all other staffs. On behalf of Athletes Federation of Bangladesh, and thanks also all of you. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Mundu sir, Mundu bhai. We call him Mundu bhai. Anyway, now, Mr. Volker, you can conclude. And I'd like to inform one information before that. On Tuesday, we'll be having our session on 9:30. Again, I'll repeatedly inform you and we'll send you invitation as well. It will be at 9:30, not at 10 o'clock. 9:30 morning, our Tuesday session will start, and Wednesday we'll be having our question and answer session. That will be the last day of session, that is 13th of this month. So please be noted on Tuesday, that is 12th, I think. 12th, the program will be at 9:30 the next week. Have a good weekend. Over to Volker Herman.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Now it's time for you to get some recovery. It was a tough week, a lot of things to learn. We see you on Monday at 10 o'clock for the next session regarding the annual structure, yeah, and how to plan your training year. Thanks to Mr. Radhakrishnan for having, again, a very informative session today. Communication skills are definitely important for all of us, not only when we're talking with our athletes, but I think in all situations applying to the daily life. Yeah, you have a good Saturday ahead. Enjoy your Sunday off, and we see you on Monday at 10 a.m. here. The same chat number. We will also share the invitation, I think, by Sunday afternoon latest. You will find, again, all the information, all the presentation on AFI's website, and I'm sure that the Sports Authority of India, that they're going to provide you with more information regarding the up to. Yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks for joining. We see you next week, Monday, 10 o'clock. Thank you. Bye.
And now I look at Kamal Ali Khan ji. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
So you can take over the session and for the attendance procedure.
Okay.
And I'm making you host. After that, you can end the meeting. Thank you very much.
Okay. Please, all respected Sai Athletic.